Hey fam, welcome back. In today's video, I am going to be sharing 5 things that I wish I knew before starting my first full-time software engineering job. These are things that I didn't learn in school, but have learned on the job throughout the 4 years that I've been working in the industry. If you are starting a software engineering job soon, this video will give you some insight in what you need to learn to ramp up faster. To give you more context, I am the first in my family to go to college, graduate, and the first to have a professional job in the tech industry. So there was a lot of information that I didn't know when I started my first full-time job. My hope with this video is to make your transition into a full-time software engineering job easier. I'd like to welcome those who are new to our channel. My name is Itzel and I am a senior software engineer. If you are interested in working in tech and looking for career guidance, this is a channel for you. Our goal is to provide you with practical advice and knowledge to help you enter and thrive in the tech industry. Let's jump right in. Everyone who joins a new company will go through an onboarding period, which is also known as a ramp-up time. This is a period of time that is required for new developers to become familiar with their new work environment before they can start to make useful contributions to a project. Based on research and personal experience, it takes at least 3 months for a new engineer to get familiar with the code base and start becoming a productive member of the team. I wish I would have known this earlier because I put a lot of pressure on myself during my first couple of weeks on the job to learn everything about my team's product, to feel comfortable navigating the code base, and to start shipping features when it had just started off. But I later learned that no one expects a new member of the team to learn all the business logic of a product or start shipping features within a few weeks. It takes months and even years for engineers with industry experience to feel fully comfortable navigating a code base. And even then, just by the nature of software development, there's always new code being added that is almost impossible to fully know every part of the code base. Another important thing to keep in mind is that when you are onboarding, that is the time when you should be asking the most questions. So don't shy away from asking any questions you may have to your team. All questions are valid when you're ramping up. One of the biggest changes you'll face when transitioning into a full-time software engineering role is learning how to navigate a large code base. If you're working at a startup, this may not be the case for you, but if you are working at a more mature company where the technology has been around for more than a few years, then you'll likely have to work with a legacy code base. Which leads me to the first thing I wish I would have learned about earlier: legacy systems. Working with legacy systems is not easy. Something that I was not exposed to in school but learned in the industry was how to work with legacy systems, which are also known as monoliths. So what is a legacy system? A legacy system has a code base that is composed of technologies that are outdated. Now, a legacy code base consists of code that is hard to understand, and there are no tests, no code comments, and no documentation that can provide you with context about that part of the business logic. It's common to be afraid to change legacy code because you don't know what workflows will break if you do. At some point in your career, you'll come across a legacy code base. And I'm not gonna lie, sometimes it's frustrating to work with legacy systems, but I also see it as a great learning opportunity because that means that you can improve your product's code base. Personally, when I was onboarded onto my team's monolithic code base, I found it to be a little daunting. Although the code was written in Python, which I was comfortable with because it was my first coding language, some of the legacy code honestly seemed like a foreign language to me. If you can relate, let me know in the comments. Sometimes it would take me a couple of hours to figure out some of the workflows in our code base, but navigating it gets better after a few months. Remember that when you are working with legacy code, you need to have a lot of patience because it takes time to figure out what specific parts of the code base do. You may even have to reach out to folks within or outside your team to get more context. Because legacy systems are so common and every company will face this at some point, there is a book titled Working Effectively with Legacy Code that provides practical advice on how to work with and improve legacy code bases. Aside from the book, I would also recommend you use the debugging tools in your integrated development environment or IDE to help you navigate parts of the code base or workflows that you are not familiar with. Number 2, you will have to go through code reviews. Another thing that I didn't have experience with until I began working in the industry was going through the code review process, which are done via pull requests, or PRs for short. The purpose of code reviews is to spread knowledge across the team about new changes being introduced and to get feedback from your teammates on how your code can improve. Some things that you'll get feedback on during code reviews are code quality and readability, missed workflows, suggestions on how to improve your code logic, and reminders to add tests to your changes if you hadn't done so. You'll also get some questions about why you decided to make a certain change and get some affirmations for using good practices and sharing knowledge. college. If you've had experience with code reviews, I'd love to hear what other things you look for in PRs. So let me know in the comments. I know from firsthand experience that when you put up your very first pull request, it can be nerve-wracking to have more experienced engineers evaluate the quality of your code, especially when you are starting off in your career. My advice is that when you see a lot of comments on your code reviews, don't see it as a negative. Be happy that your team took the time to review your changes and give you feedback on how to improve it. See it as a growth opportunity, because that's what it is. Your team is helping you grow into a better software engineer. I always feel grateful and appreciate the feedback from my team, because that means that you're invested in my growth as an engineer. Number 3, learn your team's software development process. Knowing your team's development process will help you, because that is how work gets done in products or ship. And knowing this will allow you to do your work more effectively. So what is a software development process, and why is it important? The software development process structures the work of the engineering teams, which enables them to complete all the product requirements and meet deadlines. An important tool in the software development process is a project management system. Every company will have some sort of project tracking tool that allows teams to create tickets for work that needs to get done, which are then assigned to different engineers who are responsible for completing that work. In my team, we use Jira, which is a project management tool for agile development teams. Nowadays, it seems that almost every tech company uses agile practices in their software development process, or at least they try to. If you are not familiar with the agile methodology or the Scrum process, I encourage you to read more about them. I'll link some resources in the description to help you get started. I'm sharing all of this information with you because I didn't know all of this when I was starting off, and realized that having early exposure to the processes and tools that your team uses will make it easier for you to ramp up and become a productive member of the team. Also, on the job, I learned that there are multiple development environments for a product that you'll have to familiarize yourself with during the first couple of weeks. The number of environments that a team has varies from company to company, but in my team, we have 3 environments: develop, stage, and production. The development environment is mainly used by developers. It is the first environment we push our code to and test our latest changes. It is the most unstable environment because engineers are constantly pushing new code. The stage environment is where our quality assurance team does all their testing to make sure that new and existing workflows work as expected. The production environment is the last environment in our software development process and is where a product goes live and our users come in. This should be the most stable environment. Another process I suggest you become familiar with is how your team builds and deploys new changes to your environments, and how often does it happen. Make sure to learn if your team has a continuous integration and deployment process. One thing that happens during the continuous integration and deployment process is that automated tests are run to ensure that any code changes being merged are reliable. If the build for your code changes passes all the tests, then that code is deployed to your team's environments. There are a lot of continuous integration and deployment tools out there, so make sure to ask your team what tool they use. Gaining familiarity with this process will help you ramp up faster into your team's deployment automation tools. In my team, we use Jenkins to manage our software delivery processes. To wrap this up, here's a list of good questions you should ask when you're ramping up. How many environments do we have? Do we have external facing environments? What are they used for and who uses them? What project management tool do we use? Some common tools are Jira, Asana, Smartsheets, Trello, Pivotal Tracker, and many more. How is work assigned? What software development methodology do we use? What is the process of releasing new features and how often does that happen? If your team uses sprints, how long do sprints last? Does your team set sprint goals? Does your team use spikes? What estimation system do we use for creating project timelines? Some popular ones are t-shirt sizing, Fibonacci story pointing, dot voting, planning poker, and many others. How do we deal with production issues? How and who prioritizes critical bugs? What is the process to fix issues that are bringing down production? If you're learning something new, don't forget to subscribe and give this video a thumbs up. My next advice is to set up and learn how to use your debugging tools before you start developing. This advice I did learn in school, but I didn't realize its importance until I started working full time. If you don't want to spend lots of time trying to debug with print statements, please take some time to set up your debugging tools. Your team will usually have a preferred integrated development environment, or IDE, which comes with debugging tools. But if there are no standardized tools, then I recommend you ask someone on your team what IDE they use. A debugger helps you track which methods are called and see the values of variables, inputs, and outputs at a specific point in time. I highly recommend to use a debugging tools to familiarize yourself with some of the core workflows of your product when you are ramping up. Knowing how to use a debugging tools will save you lots of time when fixing issues and make it easier to navigate your code base. In my team, we use PyCharm as our IDE, which I had to learn how to use on the job. The last thing I wish I knew before starting off was knowing about the on-call rotation responsibility. The on-call rotation was definitely something that I was not exposed to in school, and you really can't gain experience being on-call until you start working as a full-time software engineer. So what is the on-call rotation? Just like doctors go on-call to be available at all hours of the day to take care of patients with emergencies, tech companies and teams have a group of engineers who go on-call to fix any issues that are affecting your service. Engineers who are familiar with the product and have gained enough experience navigating the code base are put on the on-call rotation, which is a schedule that rotates the on-call responsibilities across everyone in the team. The on-call rotation ensures that there are always engineers available, day or night, to quickly respond to issues or outages that may arise in the service. So how does the on-call rotation work? Every company may have a different structure to their on-call rotation, so I highly recommend you ask about this during your onboarding. This is what the on-call rotation looks like for my team. There are two engineers who go on-call every week. One engineer becomes the primary on-call, who is the first line of defense. This engineer will be notified first if there is an issue and is responsible for quickly taking action to resolve that issue. And the other engineer is the secondary on-call, who is the second line of defense and is there to support the primary on-call engineer by taking on some tasks if there are just too many issues to fix. Primary and secondary on-call engineers are there to support each other and work together to resolve any issues that come up. The on-call shift for my team lasts 7 days, including weekends. So 1 week I'll be primary on-call and the next I'll become the secondary on-call. One thing that's important to know, if there is a bug in a part of the code base that you've never worked with before, you should reach out to engineers who have more experience with it and work together to fix that issue as soon as possible. No one knows everything and your team is there to help you out, not just the secondary on-call. Looking back, when I was first going on-call, I remember feeling a little bit scared and nervous because I had no prior experience quickly fixing production issues. But I promise you, it gets better over time. Every engineer new to the on-call rotation will feel nervous, so you're not alone. What I hope you take away from this section is that the reliability of your service is everyone's responsibility, not just yours. And if you need help, your team should be there to support you. To recap, these are 5 things that I wish I would have known because it would have made the transition into my first full-time software engineering job much easier, and I hope that they will help you too. If you are starting off in a new role, I'm wishing you all the best and cheering you on. I'd love to hear what tip you found the most useful, so please let me know in the comments. If you found this video helpful, please give it a thumbs up, subscribe, and share with someone whom you think can benefit from it. Thank you so much for watching, and I'll see you in our next video.